So you're saying that if you don't have iodine, it's almost a guarantee that your body is not producing certain things that it needs to produce. Yeah, it's not bringing it to its capacity.
If you go back, you know, 30 years before the advent of everybody having a cell phone and a desktop, laptop, all this other stuff, thyroid issues were a problem, significant problem. But the beauty of what Casey had presented is that the thyroids are your will center. So that's the strongest power on earth, is your free will. There's over 14,000 documented Casey readings. And in those readings, there's more than 4,400 occurrences of the term atomidine or atomic iodine. So it gives you an idea of how important he thought that this concept was.
Hey everyone, you're here with Mark on Perfect Gardens TV. So today we have a very interesting subject all around iodine. And why am I talking about this? Well, guys, it's not just about learning the subject of how to garden and how to grow plants, but once you obtain this knowledge and information, it's also about taking care of your body so that you preserve this knowledge so that you could transfer it to your kids, your family, and your loved ones. And if you're sick and you're not feeling good, then what happens to that knowledge? It gets lost, right? So today we're going to be bringing on Phil Thomas to talk a little bit about iodine. He has a wonderful product we'll be offering here on perfectgardens.com. And we just want to give a light introduction to the subject so that if you guys are interested, you can check it out and post some questions and learn more about the subject. So Phil, please tell us about yourself and tell us about iodine. Why is this so important?
Please remember to like, share, and subscribe. We got our $2.99 membership, and we have a VIP if you need a little more one-on-one. Link down in the description.
Well, my background's in the Casey reading. Casey is the father of holistic health. He was actually the guy who sort of set the standard beginning about 100 years ago, passed on in 1945. But during his lifetime, he left more than 14,000 documented readings, which were readings that he gave for individuals, most of which were health-related issues, and it was all documented. And there's a library in Virginia Beach where all that stuff is. So I went there during the 90s. I stayed there for about a decade, looked at this information. This is one of those fundamental ideas in Casey readings. He talks about the importance of iodine, and that he also discusses a method for electrically charging to detoxify it, transmute raw iodine, which is actually an halogen, into what he refers to as the atomic state. So in that state, he said that the body would be able to fully recognize and assimilate the iodine. So that's what I do with it. And, you know, iodine, as turns out, is a pretty important element.
So what is the signs of why you could possibly use iodine or need iodine in your body? Like, or is it just something that you should like just incorporate in as you're a small child?
Iodine is it's an essential element, and it bonds with living things in the ocean. So if you go back to the original hot soups idea, you know, where life came from, you find water, salt, soda, and iodine. Those are the four basic elements, which to this day are essential. All other elements can be produced actually in the body if you have those four on balance. You know, it's a revolutionary idea that, you know, Casey presented. And of course, you know, it's probably going to be another 100 or 200 years before it's validated. But
you said salt, water, iodine.
Water, salt, soda, and iodine.
Soda and iodine. Do you mean soda like sodium bicarbonate or?
Yeah, that's the most common.
And so you're saying that if you don't have iodine, it's almost a guarantee that your body is not producing certain things that it needs to produce. Yeah, is that bringing it to its capacity?
Every cell of the body needs a tiny amount of iodine in order to function.
So I'm holding your product in my hands right now, detoxified iodine. This is your product, correct?
Yes.
Yeah. What would be like the best way to get it into your system?
Well, I was talking to somebody the other day about the Japanese, why they're so capable of moving on after Fukushima. And it's because the Japanese eat seafood every day. And, you know, most Japanese do. Some of them eat 2 or 3 times a day. Iodine bonds with living things in the ocean. It doesn't actually bond with anything on dry land. So they're actually pretty well protected from the effects of the radiation. And, you know, the predominant winds are blowing out to the ocean. But still, Tokyo is only 80 miles away from Fukushima. So if they hadn't been well protected inherently in their diets, there would have been significant problems in Japan. It's a culture that, you know, is kind of unique in that sense, because they do eat a lot of seafood. So there's an example of how iodine can actually be, you know, related to the health and well-being of culture.
So what I'm hearing correctly, and tell me if this is correct, that the fallout of Fukushima couldn't have happened in any better of a place than Japan because of their diet around seafood and how iodine could possibly help with nuclear radiation and fallout?
There's two aspects of the body that are hypersensitive to radiation: the thyroid and the reproductive glands. The rest of the body can actually handle pretty large amounts of radiation, but those two aspects, for whatever reason, are hypersensitive. And when they get exposed to radiation, when you sit in front of your computer all day for, you know, 20 years, you know, you're getting small amounts of radiation, but over time, it's cumulative. And if you go back, you know, 30 years before the advent of everybody having a cell phone and a desktop, a laptop, all this other stuff, thyroid issues were a problem, significant problem. But today it's epidemic. Everybody basically has low thyroid. And that's because they've been exposed to low doses of radiation over the last 30 years that they weren't exposed to prior.
When you say radiation, are you saying like the radiation, how, I mean, I don't know if radiation comes off of our cell phones and computers and electricity, but would you mean like low radiations like that?
Yes.
Interesting. So for everyone, what does your thyroid do for you in your body?
The thyroids are at the center of the whole glandular process. The glands control the chemistry of the body. So when the thyroids go down, everything basically goes out of balance. And it can show up as many different symptoms. But when the thyroids come back up again with the use of, you know, iodine in the diet or this form, then the rest of the glandular system then has the opportunity to balance. It's not necessarily going to, depending on a multitude of variables, but the glandular system is never going to balance when the thyroids are down, because they're right at the center of the whole process.
Tell me if I'm correct, your thyroid is part of your endocrine system, right?
Right.
And it's been a while since I've been taking an anatomy class, but your endocrine system is responsible for all your hormones, right? Like your epi release, your dopamine release, your serotonin releases, and all those things, right?
Good memory.
Is that, I'm trying to remember. Okay, and so that happens all in your pancreas, right?
There's a lots of different functions. The glandular system is multi-tiered. You know, there's the pineal and the pituitary, which are up here, right? Those are the master glands. And they give the commands for the rest of the glandular system, which goes down through the thyroid, the thymus, and so on. Then as the body then adjusts, then it sends a signal back up to the pineal and the pituitary, and it says, this is where we are now. Well, the thyroids actually take the read on where the chemistry is, and that's how the pineal and the pituitary know where the rest of the glandular system is. When the thyroids are down, the pineal and the pituitary, which are the master glands giving the commands, they're basically just guessing as to what to do next.
And it's okay if you ever tell me you're not sure, because this is another subject I'm trying to connect it to. How does your endocrine system work with your endocannabinoid system?
Oh, well, that's a whole other, yeah.
Whole other conversation?
Yeah. You know, I mean, let's be honest. It's all connected. And as time goes on, we're learning more and more about how these various different systems interface. But, you know, it's an ongoing evolution.
Okay, so this is really, really interesting. Just to go back to how to take in iodine, like let's say one of our customers bought one of your iodine bottles to try out because they wanted to incorporate it into their body and health and live well system. How would they take it?
Well, what I suggest to get familiar with is to use it as a rinse and a gargle. You put 4 or 5 drops in 1/2 ounce of water, rinse and gargle 10, 15 seconds. spit it out. So you're getting a small amount actually in the system, you know, each time you do that. And, you know, once the thyroids get back up and running again, then, you know, that's usually sufficient to, you know, keep them running. But it's different for each individual, so you have to sort of assess as you go along. You know, there's a lot of different things going on in the body, so it's best for the individual to, you know, take control of their own process. And the beauty of what Casey had presented is that the thyroids are your will center. So that's the strongest power on earth, is your free will. Mm. So when you get the thyroids up and running again, you take control of your own decision-making process. And then you don't have to be dependent on what other people are saying or doing or telling you to do. You can make your own decisions.
That makes so much sense, right? Your thyroid, your pancreas, and I just forgot that specific system we were talking about, but that all deals with your emotions and like these chemicals that create this emotional response, you know, in the reality we're experiencing. Like, let's say someone yells at us, right? And we have an emotional response or a chemical response release, and people lose control possibly in a fight and they might get angry or throw something. And kind of like what you said, you're gaining control over your decision-making, which is possibly also another way of saying it, you're helping to gain control over your emotions.
Yeah, yeah. You know, like I say, it's multi-tiered. The heart actually is the center of emotions. And then you have the adrenals, which are on top of the kidneys, right? Those are the fight or flight, you know, hormones that are released there. The adrenals will, you know, send you over the edge or they'll bring you back to balance. You know? So, you know, there's lots of different things that go on with the chemistry of the body. And it's all interfaced. It's just, you know, how do you balance so that, you know, the body can move forward in a comprehensive way.
Where can people find you if they want to learn more about iodine?
I have a fair amount of information on my website, which is iodinesource.com.
Guys, I highly recommend you go check out his website. If you guys are interested in the product, you can get it at perfectgardens.com. You guys know that. But I have just started diving into iodine and the importance of iodine, because iodine is the only thing that is not available in drops of balance for trace minerals. And just like how Phil said, it's an essential mineral, you said, correct?
Element.
And like I said, you know, I'm always trying to add as little things into my body as possible to get the highest level of performance. And yeah, iodine's an incredibly interesting subject. Real quick, what would be the best time to take your product? Would it be in the morning, the afternoon, the evening, and why?
Iodine is actually a stimulant. So probably the best time to take it is in the morning, you know, and you know how you feel when you get up and you want to get going and energized. That's a good time to take it. And if you feel like the afternoon is better, then that's perfectly fine. But I don't really recommend taking it.
Okay, so you'll put three to five drops in a 1/2 ounce of water. You're going to gargle it. You're going to take it in the morning or the afternoon because iodine's a slight stimulant. And then have a good rest of the day. Cool.
Yeah.
Phil, would you like to share anything else about this subject that you think is relatively pretty important to help spark the interest in people?
You know, the Casey readings are focused on empowering the individual. And when you get to a point where you can take control of your own decision-making, then the world will move forward. And, you know, this is a critical part of it. Casey knew that, and he talked about it extensively for a few years that it was available. And there's over 14,000 documented Casey readings. And in those readings, there's more than 4,400 occurrences of the term atomidine or atomic iodine. So it gives you an idea of how important he thought that this concept was. And eventually, I think we'll probably figure it out. But, you know, evolution is a process. So hopefully we're opening the door for, you know, where we are now and for generations to come.
Guys, just like how Phil said, our free will leads to our sovereign power. And this is just another thing why we garden, why we grow our own food, why we grow our own medicine. is to gain our sovereign power back from the people and the entities that want to rob us of our potential energy and our potential power. Phil, thank you so much for coming onto the channel and giving us a light introduction to iodine, an incredibly important subject. Please remember to like, share, and subscribe, and have a great grow, everyone.
Hi, Mark. I was just curious, on these 100-gallon potters and the 55 or 50-gallon potter, how much water do you think we should be putting them in? Should it, you know, just a roundabout idea, because I have a feeling we're underwatering, and I'm just not positive, because I'm not positive how much comes out of the pump, and I don't know how to even explain this. Anyhow, I'm just curious, how many gallons do you think we should be putting in these potters? Just an idea of how many. Thanks.